Okay, good morning. Today is Tuesday, November 10th. We do have the midterms to hand back today. Some of you did really well. A handful of people got 100%, but there were a number of students that got like 40%, which is not good. We had trouble with the video last week. Janet has posted the link online. Has anyone had trouble finding it? And also she listed some notes from that video from the Futures Now, and please treat that as required viewing, I guess is the right word. There's some interesting information on there that could show up on the exam. So today I would like to finish our discussion of fundamental and technical analysis. Last week I think I finished up describing price behavior in a typical commodity market, and we characterize the stochastic process as being non-stationary, which means that it does not return to its mean. It's not like predicting the temperature in Honolulu. That's pretty easy compared to predicting the price of sugar or the price of gold. So as a result, we can characterize the price movement as being described by a random walk, loosely speaking, which means that the markets are informationally efficient. It's hard to beat. It's hard to make money trading in the futures market. So just a little bit more about efficient markets. Some of this I gave you last time, but when I talk about informationally efficient, it means that all available supply and demand information is reflected in the price. Of course, if it's unavailable, probably not in the price because we don't know what it is yet. But if it's available and it's public information, you can bet that it is reflected in the price, because if it isn't, it's in the interest of traders to arbitrage the information they have and what's going on in the market. In reality, these markets are probably partially efficient. It's hard to measure whether the markets are completely efficient. And one of the reasons is that the markets reflect information that's maybe imperfect. We don't know exactly what's going to happen with the weather this coming spring in the Midwest, yet the corn prices today are trying to reflect the expectation of what's going to happen, the anticipation. So that information obviously is not perfect. If you have a better idea of what the weather is going to be like in Iowa in the months of June and July, then maybe you can beat the market. And there's information that's other than fundamental. Okay, supply and demand means fundamental information. But there are other traders in the marketplace. Okay? And we talked about the technical traders. So the technical traders, they do not worry about too much about fundamental information. And in the futures market, every dollar is a vote, right? So if you have a large number of traders who are following technical trading rules, and they think the price is going to move in a certain direction, and they all take positions accordingly, then the law of self-fulfilling expectations will kick in, and the price will move in that direction for some time period, because every dollar is a vote. So if you have a flood of technical traders who decide to go long in the sugar market, then perhaps the sugar price is going to go up. Is that reflecting fundamental information? Probably not. Does that mean that the market is completely efficient at that point? Probably not. Okay. Eugene Fama, who was a famous financial economist, he defined the term efficient market. And according to Eugene Fama, at any point in time, the asset's price will be a good estimate of its intrinsic value. In other words, on any given day in the market, if you look at the price of nearby crude oil or distant crude oil, that future's price will be a good estimate of its intrinsic value. What does that mean? That means what is the value based on the fundamentals, the supply and demand. So it's a good estimate. It's not a perfect estimate. And I think I told you early on in class that if you look at something like the crude oil market or the corn market, and you're trying to determine what the price might be next year or 2 years from now, probably the best estimate, it's a good estimate, it's probably the best estimate, is found in the futures price. Does that mean that it's a perfect estimate? Of course not, because information changes, and it may actually be a very poor predictor. We don't know if the price of oil next year is going to be $100 or if it's going to be $30. Okay? The market's saying about $50. But that's the best estimate we have as of today based on supply and demand information as of today. If you've been reading about OPEC this week, there was a big article about OPEC yesterday in the financial newspapers, and the story was that OPEC is not going to reduce production. Okay, oil's below $50 a barrel. The oil companies are losing money, and they were hoping that OPEC would reduce production. They used to do that to try to control the supply. One reason oil is as low as it is today is they made a decision about a year ago to maintain their market share. So they're going to continue to pump oil, and they're hoping that the high-cost producers might exit the market. And they had a meeting last week, I believe, and they reaffirmed their position that they're going to continue to pump oil. And OPEC believes that the price is going to hit $70 sometime in the next few years because the high-cost producers will be driven out of the market. Well, if you look at the futures prices, they don't necessarily believe that. And it's just like when we listen to Janet Yellen talk about a hike in the Fed fund rate. You know, she says one thing, the markets say another. If you've been watching that, and I hope you have, which direction has that probability gone on the Fed fund rate since the jobs report last week? It's gone up. Any idea where it is today? It was around 50% when we looked at it in class, right? I think it was around 50. It's closer to 70% now. So that's based on that jobs report last week, which has now increased the probability. So I think you get the idea here that there's information out there. The markets adjust to that information. So if you look at the Fed fund futures, it's changed dramatically since we talked about it in class, which wasn't that long ago. And why is that? Because the Labor Department came out with a report on jobs last week. I sent you that article. I think it was last Friday. And it was very positive, indicating there's been strong job growth. And that suggests there's a greater probability that she will raise the interest rate. And in fact, that's what the futures market is telling us. There are other economists who have discussed this notion of efficient markets. Richard Thaler argues there are a certain number of irrational traders who can distort the price, and he points to the bubble in the stock market in 2000. Here's a graph that Janet will post for you because I just put it together. And it relates to this issue of irrational traders or inefficient markets. So what do we have here? The red line is the price of WTI crude oil. Okay. And it goes back to 2006. And we're going to read the price of oil off of the right-hand side here. So you see the peak here, the price was, you know, approximately $140, and that was in 2008. And today, it's down here at $45, okay? So that's the price of oil. There was an op-ed, an editorial in the Wall Street Journal last week. I don't know if any of you saw it. Did anybody read this This is a short editorial, and the title was something, Windfall Losses in the Oil Industry. Anybody read that? No? Okay. I know some of you are reading the Wall Street Journal. If you see an article that deals with commodity markets, I suggest you look at it. Windfall Losses in the Oil Industry. Kind of an interesting title, right? It's kind of a play on words. Because we talk about windfall profits, but we rarely talk about windfall losses. And what they were referring to was what happened in 2008, when the price of oil went to $140 a barrel. There were a lot of politicians, there were a lot of so-called analysts, who blamed the speculators. And they said that the price did not reflect the fundamentals. So it gets back to this point about efficient markets. So they were essentially arguing that the markets were inefficient and that oil wasn't really worth $140. The only reason it went to $140 was because of the evil speculators. We had congressional hearings. We had our president make public statements about this. If you go back and search, you'll find some very amazing statements, basically blaming the run-up and the price of oil on speculation. It turns out that could never be proven, it could never be shown, and there was probably no truth to that argument, although it was a popular statement to make if you were a politician. You blame the speculators and the oil companies were making windfall profits. It turns out there's no evidence that that was true, so in other words, the market was rational in 2008. That was the intrinsic value of oil in 2008. And when the price of oil ran up to 140, guess what? We started expanding production in the United States. This technology that had been lying around called fracking came into play, and the U.S. started expanding production, and also usage went down, and so the price fell. The blue line is the net speculative position, okay? The correlation between the red line and the blue line is minus 0.03. It's almost zero, okay? So these politicians who are blaming the speculators unfortunately never looked at the data. So these data are from, as you know, the CFTC, Commitment to Traders Report, and the blue number we read off the left-hand side, okay? And it's the number of longs minus the number of shorts, the volume. So this is over here. So we see that it was hovering around zero, and it was even negative when prices peaked. So when prices peaked, speculators were on the short side, okay? They thought the price was gonna fall, and it turns out they were right. And the spec positions were kind of hovering around short and long, around zero, and more recently in the last 3 years, the speculative positions have gone net long, so they're net long now, and that suggests that they believe what OPEC is saying, that prices are going back to $70 a barrel. So these are not the swap dealers. These are not managed money. Managed money is pretty well always net long. Swap dealers, we don't know if they're hedging or speculating. A lot of their positions are hedgers, so this is actually just the reportable, the large speculators. So when I look at this chart, I believe this supports the argument that markets are informationally efficient and they're rational. And if you go back and look at that op-ed article which appeared last week, it was pretty much tongue-in-cheek, but what it was saying was, gee, all these politicians were complaining when the price of oil went to $140, and they were calling for regulation on speculators and a clampdown on their behavior because this high price of oil was causing, all this great harm. And now that oil has fallen to $45, they haven't said a word, right? They're not complaining about the oil workers who have lost their jobs. They're not complaining about the people who own stock in Chevron or Exxon who have lost all kinds of money. They're not blaming the speculators for the fall in the price. So, you know, why not? If they were to cause, they were the cause of the rise in price, how come you're not talking about what's happened when the price fell? And you can see they're net long, so you could hardly say that this price fall is due to these guys. So I thought that was a good illustration of this debate over informational efficiency. Okay. So if the market is highly efficient, how is it that you can make money trading futures contracts? Well, not everybody's like Ken Roberts. A lot of speculators lose money. I've told you that. That's no secret. So how can you beat the market? Well, there are some possibilities. You have to use information in some way that's different than what other traders are using it. You have to interpret it more accurately. We talked about the weather. You know, the price of corn in 2016 is going to be highly dependent on whether this El Nino pans out. And we're not even sure whether El Nino, you look at some of the maps, El Nino could mean drought conditions in the Midwest. If that's the case, then corn's going to go from 325 or wherever it is now. Yan's going to check. back to $7 or $8. So this is an opportunity to interpret that information more accurately or to anticipate changes in the non-informational aspects. So that would be the speculative technical traders. So let's just talk about fundamental analysis briefly. I think I've been fairly clear that there's a big question mark as to whether or not technical analysis is of any use whatsoever, given that prices follow a random walk. But what about fundamental analysis? Well, it makes more sense, but it's very difficult. A technical trader can trade 10 or 20 or 30 different markets very easily. That's why the hedge funds and the managed money and the Ken Roberts of the world tend to follow technical trading rules, because they can simply enter the data in their computer and you know, every single morning the computer is going to tell them whether they should go long sugar, short treasury bonds, long or short in gold, long or short in cattle, etc. It's just a simple arithmetic calculation for most of the technical approaches. Whereas a fundamental trader must understand the markets, must study the supply and demand information, and that takes a lot of time and effort and expertise. And you couldn't possibly be a thorough expert on more than a handful of markets, because there's too much information. So there's a lot of information that makes it difficult. I also pose the question, what is a fact, right? We're going on certain factual information, but sometimes that information is imprecise. So I give you an example in the textbook of the USDA Hog and Pigs Report. Every quarter, the U.S. Department of Agriculture surveys farmers, and they ask them, you know, how many pigs were born on their farm compared to a year ago, and, you know, when those pigs are going to go to market, and so on and so forth. And you would think with hog production, the supply and demand would be more manageable, because it's basically a biological process, right? It doesn't depend too much on the weather. Yet, the hog and pig reports are quite often big surprises to the market. Can I help you? You okay? They're often big surprises to the market, and that the market doesn't anticipate the number that's going to be released. Okay? So here's a dedicated student, right? I've got 100 students who aren't here today who can walk and ride their bike, and Sky shows up in crutches. So welcome. And thank you for coming. So when the Hog and Pig report comes out, you have to take it with a certain grain of salt because even though that information is based on surveys, sometimes it's not very precise. And I give you an example in the book of where a number of years ago they came out with a report and they said, well, there was a lot more pigs born on farms than a year ago. So that means, you know, in 4 or 5 months' time, we're going to have a big increase in the supply of pigs going to market. Well, it turns out they never did show up, okay? There's a guy at USDA who's still looking for them, in fact. We don't know what happened. If they, in fact, were born on the farms, they never went to market. They must have escaped. So there's a lot of information, but there's also a certain imprecision associated with that information. And I've already talked to you about orange juice. You know, the movie Trading Places talks about the release of the orange juice reports, and I highly recommend that movie now that you know something about futures trading. And it talks about the secrecy surrounding the report and how the market responds when these reports are released. Paul?
I'm just wondering, is that Hog report not a trusted report anymore?
Good question. Is that Hog report not a trusted report? Well, the bottom line is there's no better information. Okay. It's very expensive to survey all the hog producers in the United States. There are private analysts who try to come up with their own numbers. And as I said, once in a while, the hog report is just like a total surprise. And so you wonder, you know, is it really true that there was this big increase in the number of pigs born? Or, you know, is there some error here? Or are the farmers not telling the truth on the forms? You know, so it's imprecise. Is it not trusted? I guess you take it with a grain of salt, but there's not much better in the way of information. And usually the market responds when it comes out. So typically the market puts more faith in that than anything else they might have. Do you have a question? Yeah. Yeah, they could. Yeah, the farmers could. They could, you know, misrepresent the numbers. But you know, I don't think there's any reason that they would act in concert and do that. So when you look at fundamental information in these markets, there's certain basic things that are useful. So here's just an example. This is called the hog-corn ratio. And this number, when it's high, it means that hogs are profitable. And the ratio is the price of 100 pounds of hogs divided by the price of a bushel of corn. Okay, so if the price of hogs goes up and the price of corn doesn't change, then the ratio is going to increase. Alternatively, if the price of corn goes up and the price of hogs doesn't change, the ratio is going to decrease. And so what happens through time, this I mentioned is a biological process. When hogs are profitable, the hog-corn ratio is way up here at 24. Then you're going to see an increase in supply of hogs. And then guess what? A few years later, the price is going to be lower again. So traders do pay attention to certain simple, fundamental pieces of information like that. So I'm talking about what is a fact, right? I mentioned to you this guy, T. Boone Pickens. He predicts $200 a barrel of oil. This was in August of 2008 when price hit 140. Last year, same guy. He doesn't think WTI will hit $70 this year. Whoops. There he is. Okay. He's a guy who's made billions of dollars in the oil industry. This was just last week. He thinks oil is going to hit $70 by year end. So it's hard to say. And now OPEC is saying $70, but not by year end. Okay, T. Boone Pickens is still one of the holdouts there. Yes. So Jan's question is, how could a single guy get all the information? Well, I guess the answer to that is he's not a very good predictor of the price of oil, right? he's been mostly wrong, at least with his public statements. So the answer to your question is, he's made a lot of money in the oil business, but he also started with a lot of money. And I guess the money he's made hopefully it hasn't depended on his ability to predict the price of oil. So I think the answer to your question is that one guy can't do it because he's not very good at it. So just another illustration, you know, if you're reading the newspapers. So this was just before our quarter started. Here's the Wall Street Journal. Oil surges as supply estimate shrink. That was September 1st. The very next day, in a different newspaper, it says oil bear forecast return to $25 a barrel. Okay, so you've got two stories sort of telling the opposite in terms of where prices are going. Also, before the quarter started, there was a lot of press about the Fed fund rate, and we're still reading about that. Economists react to the August jobs report. A September hike is basically a coin flip, 50-50 chance, right? That was September 4th, September 8th. One of the members of the Federal Reserve says we're probably going to raise the rates this year. So I think you're aware of that. If you're reading the newspapers, you're going to see conflicting information. And that's what makes it interesting, because you can try and sort through that conflicting information and determine which side of the argument is most valid. So fundamentalists, they look into all this supply and demand information. They pay attention to elasticities. We talked about that early on in the class, right? Especially for products like coffee. There's a few key players in the world coffee market. And if there's a problem with supply, let's say cold weather in Brazil in July, that's going to have an effect on the coffee price. And we looked at some statistics earlier on in this quarter where a small change in the supply of coffee can have a very big impact on the price. So here's a graph similar to something I put up earlier in the quarter, and it shows the price of coffee last year, and the price rose from $1.05 to $1.80, based on weather reports coming out of Brazil. Okay, that was the main driver here, and the markets believe that if there was a cold snap in the winter time in Brazil, which is our summertime, the price of coffee was going to skyrocket. As you know, not if you're buying coffee in the MU, you'd never notice, but now the price has come back down to here, right? You get free coffee, Shelley, Damien? No? Okay. Here's another example. Hurricane Sandy in the Gulf, 2012, and the price of gasoline futures. So there's a lot of offshore drilling, there's a lot of refineries, there's a lot of distribution systems in the Gulf. And this was the hurricane season when the price of gasoline rose quite sharply based on anticipated impacts of the hurricane. It turns out the hurricane wasn't as severe as what some of the predictions had said, and therefore the price came back down again. Okay, we're talking about fundamental analysis. I've explained that it probably is the most rational way to approach the markets, but it is very difficult. There's a lot of information, and it's hard to assess what information is valid and what isn't. Excuse me. And obviously each market is going to have its own characteristics. In the coffee market, there's a few key producing regions, and an important driving force is the weather. Right? In the hog market, a key factor are those USDA reports and the price of hogs relative to the price of corn. The price of feed accounts for about 70% of the cost of producing a hog. So if the price of corn rises because of a drought next summer, that's going to drive down the profitability of hogs, and you're probably going to see a decline in the supply of hogs. So every market has its own unique economic fundamentals that are at play, and obviously, depending on which market you are in, some fundamentals are more important than others. You know, the weather is not as important for the oil market, although we do have situations where there's hurricanes or weather events, but it's not as important as it is, let's say, for orange juice, where orange juice is only produced in Florida and Brazil. So it's two regions of the world, and given that the production is so concentrated, the role of weather is extremely important. Currencies. We'll go to currencies now. And there's different ways to trade currencies from a fundamental standpoint. And one approach is to try and determine the intrinsic value of currencies. So if you've been reading the financial press, the US dollar at the present time is extremely high. It rose again this week because of the jobs report. And that begs the question, you know, when is that going to turn? When is the yen going to come back? When is the euro going to come back? The dollar is very high. So there's something called the purchasing power parity theory that is kind of a useful way to look at exchange rates. And I'm going to talk about an illustration of the PPP, which is just, we're not going to take it too seriously, but it's something The Economist magazine does periodically. They look around the world and they collect information on what the price of a Big Mac is in various countries. In case you've never been to McDonald's, a Big Mac is a hamburger. So it's a homogeneous product. If you have a Big Mac in Moscow, it probably tastes the same as one in Davis. Or if you have one in Beijing, it probably tastes more or less the same. It's a pretty homogeneous product. So that's why they've chosen this to determine whether currencies are overvalued or undervalued. And what they do is they measure how much a hamburger costs you if you're paying in US dollars, and you go into a restaurant in Tokyo, or you go into a restaurant in Moscow, or you go into a restaurant in Oslo. How much does it cost you in US dollars? You compare that to the price at home in the US, and that gives you some idea of whether or not that foreign currency is overvalued or undervalued. If it's really cheap in Moscow, you know, if a hamburger over there costs you $1.50 in US dollars, then that suggests that the ruble is undervalued. Now, the theory is based on a basket of commodities. It's not just based on one hamburger, but the hamburger allows us to illustrate the idea. But the economic theory is that if you have a large basket of commodities and the currencies are arbitraged, in the long run, the basket of goods should cost the same, more or less the same, irrespective of which country you buy it in. So if you have a list of goods and you buy those goods in Europe and you come over to the U.S. and you buy that same basket of goods, it should cost more or less the same irrespective of what currency you're using. And if they do cost the same, then those currencies adhere to the law of one price. So what is the law of one price? It says, well, there's only one price of a good because of arbitrage. And arbitrage will tend to equilibrate these prices, right? So right now, the euro, the European currency, is quite low, right? It's about 1.1 to a dollar. But I remember in 2008, 6 or 7 years ago, the euro was extremely strong. It was about 1.6 to the dollar. So it's fallen dramatically. At that time, I happened to be in San Francisco, and I had some time to kill. So I went into an auto dealership that was selling German cars, not Volkswagen. No. starts with a P, very nice cars, very expensive cars. And I talked to this dealer, and I was looking at cars, and I asked him, you know, how business was going. And he said, oh, it's great. He said, yesterday I sold 3 cars to Europeans. I said, what? Yeah, he said, they fly over here and buy a Porsche, take it over to Oakland, put it on a boat, and ship it to Europe. I said, well, isn't that where it came from? He said, yeah. But the currency was such that the dealership, or the manufacturer, I should say, was pricing the cars in the US at a rate that they were hoping to sell some. And if you brought euros over, the cars were much cheaper here than what they were in Europe. So that was, I thought, a great illustration of the law of one price. Those cars should cost the same in Europe as they cost here if the markets are arbitraged. So that's the purchasing power parity theory. It says exchange rates should equalize the price of the good in 82 countries. So we start with the Big Mac, and let's say it costs $2.30 in Davis, California. We finally did allow a McDonald's to come into Davis. Somewhere in Davis, I'm not sure where, but...
By the dealership.
Oh, it is by the dealership. Okay. You just... How do you know that? Do you eat the hamburgers? Okay. Talk to me after class, okay? So it's $2.30, and so if we look around the world and find out what the price is in other countries, this gives us an idea of the extent to which the other currencies are overvalued or undervalued. Okay, so let's look at a few examples, okay? So here's... the price in Japan. So the price in Davis is $2.30. Okay. If we go to Tokyo, and I suppose, Jan, if you flew to Japan, the first place you go is McDonald's, right? Maybe. Okay. Well, let's pretend the first place you go is McDonald's, and you order a hamburger, and you notice it's 391 yen. You think, geez, that's kind of expensive because you exchanged your dollars at the airport and the exchange rate was 100 yen to the dollar, right? So you get 100 yen to the dollar, you buy hamburgers, 391 yen. That math is pretty easy, right? You're paying $3.91 in your currency, the US currency, for a hamburger in Japan. So that suggests that the Japanese yen is overvalued relative to the dollar. If it adhered to the law of one price, this would also be $2.30. So we can calculate the implied purchasing power rate by writing down the equation $2 $1.30, that's our price in US dollars, times the PPP rate, okay, this is the PPP rate, and that's going to give us 391 yen. In other words, what this equation tells us, if the exchange rate, instead of 100 to 1, that it was some other ratio, what ratio would that be such that these prices are equal, right? So you just have to divide one price by the other. If you divide 391 by 230, that's what we do in the next slide, then we get a PPP rate of 170. 391 yen divided by $2.30. Okay, so that's the PPP rate. So what this tells us, if when Yang got off the airplane and went to change his money, if they gave him 170 yen per dollar, then he went and bought his hamburger, he wouldn't complain because he'd do a quick calculation. He's always got his phone out, right? And he'd see that, gee, it costs the same price as at home, so that's not bad. So given that the exchange rate's 100 to 1, but it's not 170, 170 is the PPP rate, okay, then we say that the Japanese yen is overvalued to the tune of 70%. So if you use this logic, then you would predict that the yen is going to depreciate, decline in value. So let's suppose Yan continues on his trip to Australia. And he goes to Australia, and when he passes through the airport there in Sydney, they give him $1.42 Australian for every dollar US. Okay? And naturally, he goes straight to McDonald's, right? And he buys his favorite food, and he pays $2.45 for the Big Mac. And he thinks to himself, gee, that's a pretty good price, right? Because $2.45 divided by 230 is 1.07, and they're giving me 1.42. So the difference between 1.42 and 1.07 is 25%. So the Australian dollar is undervalued by the tune of 25% because the hamburgers for yen is cheaper in Australia. It only costs him $1.72 US dollars for that same hamburger. So knowing him, he'd probably have two. But the idea is, when you look around the world, these currencies are going to fluctuate. Items like hamburgers or Porsches or other desirable goods are going to vary in price after you adjust for the exchange rate. And the idea is that in the long run, these exchange rates are going to be pushed towards their PPP rate. Okay, so the Aussie dollar is going to be pushed from 1.42 towards 1.07. The Japanese yen is going to be pushed from 100 towards 170, if you believe in this theory. So here's a graph from The Economist magazine, and I apologize, it's a little bit hard to read because there's so many numbers on it. But it shows the price of Big Macs in a number of different countries relative to the price in the United States. And if the bar is to the right, that means the Big Mac costs more in the foreign country than it does at home. And if it's to the left, it means that it costs less. So what's amazing is at the present time, so this was just a month or so ago, you could travel almost anywhere in the world and eat at McDonald's and you're paying less than what you are at home. But yeah, and I suggest you avoid Switzerland and Norway. Okay? Your budget's going to be broken there. In Norway, a Big Mac costs you $5.65. So the kroner is overvalued by 18%. But if you go to Venezuela, yeah, 67 cents for a hamburger. So that currency is way undervalued. Yeah. So this question is this method very accurate? It is in the long run if you have a basket of currencies, not just a hamburger, right? This is just to illustrate it, right? Just for fun. But if you have a large basket of commodities and you can find those rates, you can find the PPP rate. And what this theory says is, you know, a currency is not going to remain overvalued or undervalued for too many years. It's eventually going to come back in line, right? And so right now, the US dollar is really strong compared to most of these currencies. And what that suggests is that the dollar is probably going to fall in value over the next 3 years. And that's not an unreasonable point of view, right? That's all it's telling us. So it's a good time to go traveling. Pardon? Yeah, and your burgers. Except you come home overweight, right? Especially if you go to Latin America. Okay, any questions on the PPP rate? Okay, that's good. I'm going to switch to chapter 6, and we'll get finished that today. We'll go on to 7 on Thursday, and next week we're going to do 8. So these chapters will all be on the midterm. So you should have read through chapter 8 probably by the end of this week, if you really want to keep up with me, okay? I'm not going to spend much time on technical analysis, just go over the kind of the high points. A chartist studies past prices, ignores supply and demand, okay? As I said, it's popular because it's very easy. A lot of the charting techniques that are out there are variations on a theme. A lot of them are inherited from the stock market, because if you look at a chart of stock prices, you know, we draw these charts where we have the vertical line and then the horizontal line, the typical bar chart. You can do the same thing for the price of a stock. And so the same techniques are used for stock prices as futures prices. And, you know, if you read some of the magazines or watch late night TV or look at Ken Roberts' website, you know, you're going to see descriptions of their trading systems. Along the following lines: cycle busters, market masters, power traders, and so on. All pretty catchy. There's a lot of managed money that uses technical trading rules, because that keeps the cost of the staff down and you get the computers to tell you whether to go long or short. Most of these, if they're registered with the CFTC, have to issue a prospectus, so you can actually learn something about the trading systems they use, and I've looked at some of these, and usually they're just a variation on a theme. They give it a catchy title, right, like Cycle Buster or Power Traders or something like that, but the truth is you can always boil it down to 3 or 4 standard approaches, and they have some variation on that. So the first is the old standard patterns on price charts. Looking at a bar chart, this started in the stock market. You look at a bar chart and you look for recurring patterns, whether it's a head and shoulders pattern or, you know, triple bottom. They have different words for these. And they look at a chart and they say, I've seen this pattern before, therefore the price is going higher, it's going lower. The second method is trend following. It's very simple. It uses moving averages. It tries to identify a trend in the market, and the belief is a trend is your friend, right? If the market is trending upwards and you get in on the long side, then you can make a lot of money as it moves up, or vice versa. The problem is you enter into a choppy market, like the crude oil market's been in the last 6 months. It's been chopping around $50. It hasn't trended anywhere. That system is not going to make you money. It might make you money over the short term, but in the long term, probably not. The third group is generally called oscillators, and that looks for the character of a market analysis. And I'll talk about something called a stochastic indicator this morning. And what that does is it looks, it first of all defines a certain number of days for a price range. So it could be 10 days, it could be 15, it could be 20, it doesn't matter. All these systems will give different parameters, okay? So Ken Roberts might have his set of parameters. He might use a 15-day stochastic, and the next person might use a 5-day stochastic. But they're basically the same concept. And what that does is it looks at price range over the past 10 days and whether or not the current settlement price, today's settlement price, is near the top of that range or the bottom of that range. And that's an indication of whether the market is overbought or oversold. It's almost a contrarian point of view. And then you have these characters out there who go back and they look at markets over the past 5 years, 10 years, 100 years, decades long, and they look at these long run changes and they, you know, what, there's one branch called the Elliott Wave Theory. And I'm sure you've never heard of this, but take my word for it. There are, you know, tens of thousands of people who believe in this stuff, and they trade the gold market accordingly based on long-run trends. So let me just give you a few examples. Here's a typical bar chart that we've looked at before, you know, where the vertical line is the difference between the low and the high. This looks like weekly prices. And the horizontal line is the close. So you draw your chart. Before we had computers, I told you people used to sit up in the viewer's gallery and draw these by hand on graph paper. You draw your chart, and then you try and identify a trend. So here, this is a chart in treasury bonds. It doesn't matter what it is. It could be in, you know, the price of Tesla stock. It could be the price of sugar. Computer doesn't care. And the trade is to follow a bear channel. And so this was a comment on the bond market that I found with the technical trader. The trade is following a bear channel. So in other words, if you draw those two black lines, we're in a downward channel. Okay, that looks believable. And favor sell-offs, but Friday's reversal could prompt correction. So you see that what happened is that the price is ready to break out of the channel. And that's what a technician will look for. Okay, we're in this channel. The price is going to break out of it. Here's the price of sugar. You can simply fit a trend line, right, and trade accordingly. The trend is down, so we're going to be short in the sugar market. More typically, what trend-following methods do is they calculate a moving average. So what's a moving average? Well, a moving average is a weighted average of, let's say, settlement prices. So you update the average with today's settlement price, and then you drop off the oldest settlement price. So if we have, let's say, a 10-day moving average, or here I'm talking about a 25-day moving average, if it's a 25-day moving average, you take the settlement prices over the last 25 days and you calculate the average. And the larger the number of days included, the smoother this line will be, right? The bar chart is pretty choppy. It basically smooths out the prices because if you have a 25-day moving average, then each particular day, its weight is worth 4%. If you had a 5-day moving average, then each particular day, its weight is worth 20%. So 4 days is going to be a nice smooth line. 5 days is going to be a line that's not quite so smooth. And what the chartists do is then they compare the bar chart with the moving average, and they look at that difference to decide whether or not they're going long or short. So the moving average will always lag behind the actual price because you're dropping old prices and adding new ones. And if prices are going up, prices are rising, then the moving average is going to be below the price. If prices are going down, then the moving average is going to be above the price. So what the chartists do is they look for when those two cross. When the moving average crosses the settlement price, and that will be a signal to buy or sell. So here's an example where we have our bar chart. It's kind of all over the place. Those are the blue lines. Then that moving average is the green line, and it's a nice smooth line. So that's probably, I just forget, it could be a 25-day moving average. And you see when the prices are falling in the center there, the moving average is above the price. And then when prices start to turn, they turn up before the moving average does, because these weights are only 4% each. Then it crosses through. Then that might be a signal to reverse from short to long. So you would have been short up on top when the price crashed through the moving average. You would have maintained a short position. You would have made some money in this market because it was a nice trend. Then you reverse, and then you go long. So this will work if you find a market that has these nice long trends in prices. And you can show your friends that, okay, if you had done this over the past year, you would have made a lot of money in this market. But that's absolutely not a good idea because, you know, the chances of that trending again are fairly small. So that's trend following. Moving average is typical in trend following. If you subscribe to the Wall Street Journal and you go to the page that has the futures prices, and you go down to the bottom and you click on the price chart, and you look below, there's all kinds of technical indicators that you can choose. Has anybody found that in the Wall Street Journal? No? Okay, well, it's there if you're interested. You can put in moving averages, you can put in oscillators, stochastics has a wealth of indicators that are built in. Then you just click the button and it redraws the chart. Character of market analysis. This is the oscillator family that I was talking about. They look for the quality of a price move. Okay, the moving average was just, are we in an uptrend or in a downtrend? This looks for, quotes, the quality of a price move. And the simplest would just look for a certain price change over time, okay, and chart that price change. And they're based on the notion that the markets can be overbought or oversold and a price trend can reverse itself. So according to the oscillator theory, if the price has been moving higher and higher and higher, then that oscillator is going to increase. That's going to indicate that the market is maybe overbought and it's time to go short, and vice versa, if it's lower and lower and lower. So here's an example of a 30-day oscillator. So this line here is simply a price change over the past 30 days. So you just plot that, right? So the first observation, the price change over the past 30 days is minus 10%. Then we get up here to zero. And then we get up to plus 10%. So up there, the price change over the past 30 days on whatever this day happens to be, and we don't care too much, is 10%. That crosses our threshold line. So it's time to sell, okay? So Ken Roberts would charge you $1,000 for this method. But that's all it does. It calculates how much the price has changed, and you set the parameter. You can set this to 50 days. You can set it to 10 days. It's your choice. You can look in the Wall Street Journal and choose, and you can see what it looks like. You set that parameter, and then you set where the dashed line is. That's your choice. And when it crosses the dashed line, whether it's on top or it's on bottom, that's when you go into the market. So So if it crosses the dashed line up on top, then we say the market's overbought. It's risen 10% in the last 30 days. Time it's going to go down. It's kind of a contrarian trading technique. Okay, we talked about trend following. We talked about character of market analysis, and I'm going to give you a couple of examples at the end from the markets yesterday. And then we have these structural theories, these long-run theories. Okay? So one long-run theory is a seasonal approach. And in some of these markets, there is some seasonality, okay? I'll give you that. So maybe that's a respectable approach. If you watch late night TV, there's a character on there who believes in cycles, seasonality. That's what he does 24/7. And, you know, he talks about the natural gas market because it's cold in the winter, okay? We all know that. So, you know, he argues that you could make a lot of money if you buy his trading system, and what he's going to tell you to do is go long natural gas in October and, you know, go short in March, and you're going to make a lot of money. Well, some years you will if it gets really cold, and that's a surprise. We know the price of natural gas is going to jump. Heating oil is going to jump. But there's a large number of technical traders who look at seasonality, and they go into the market a certain time of year, a certain side of the market, and they exit. So it's a very predefined trading strategy, kind of irrespective of where the price is. There's some other longer run approaches that in my view are more questionable. There's one called the Kondratieff cycle that's based on very long-term patterns, okay? And this guy, Nikolai Kondratieff, he was actually thrown in jail in 1930 by Joseph Stalin. And Nicholas ended up perishing in prison for his views that cycles are due to the inherent nature of capitalism. So he argued that these long-run patterns over 30 years or 50 years or 100 years are not random. And if you pick up a book on the Kondratieff cycle, it kind of gives you a headache to look at all those charts in the book that go back decades and decades, in some cases centuries, looking at prices. There's another very popular approach called the Elliott Wave approach. And as I told you, a lot of these approaches came from the stock market. So you have Kondratieff cycles in the stock market, just like you have Kondratieff cycles in the gold market or the sugar market, if you believe it. There's another guy called Ralph Elliott, right? And he was a very modest person. He wrote a book called Nature's Law, The Secret of the Universe, 1942. And he still has a lot of followers who believe in what he wrote. And he believed in counting waves of price advances and declines based on the Fibonacci. Fibonacci was an Italian statistician, price series, right? Where each number is the sum of the previous two. So it goes 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus 2 is 5, 3 plus 5 is 8, and so on. So if you look, pick up a book based on the Elliott wave theory, you're going to see these waves that follow this Fibonacci pattern, right? And he believes that there's a rhythm in nature that spills into the stock markets and the commodity markets, and that rhythm is revealed through these waves of higher and lower prices. So that's another area that you can be thankful I won't assign you to read. Okay, this morning I sent you a piece from the Wall Street Journal. There's the title, Hedge Funds Load Up on Sugar. So this graph down here shows the net position of the hedge funds, and they've gone long in sugars, and the price of sugar has risen about 30% since August, and we've been reading a little bit about the sugar market. And this article talks about the fact that the fundamentals are somewhat positive for the sugar market because production is less than consumption in this year. So earlier in the quarter, we read about the oversupply in the market, and now there's some suggestion that on the fundamental side, there's a little bit of enthusiasm. So here's the position. Here's the change in the positions for sugar under the commitment of traders reports. And as I said, the non-commercials have expanded their position by more than 26,000 contracts. So they're taking a very strong long position. And then if you look at the technicals, here's a bar chart of the sugar market, and these are moving averages, okay? So I've charted the 18-day moving average, which is a smoother line, the green line, than the red line. The red line is a little more volatile, and that would be the 9-day moving average, okay? So as I said, the more the number of days, the smoother the price. If we look at this, sugar's been rising. We know that since the quarter started. But look what's happened the last few days. It's crossed below the 18-day moving average. So if you look at some of the technical analysts, so this person says the market's back below the 18-day moving average. The market is back below the 18-day moving average, suggests the intermediate term trend could be turning down. Okay, so this tells us to sell. Whereas these hedge funds are buying. So here we have an instance where the fundamentals, and I want you to read the article I sent you this morning, fundamentals are suggesting maybe sugar is going higher, whereas if you pay attention to what the technical traders are saying, some of them are saying the price is going lower. And this is just one example. There's lots of technical traders out there. I'm sure you could come up with one who has a different approach and is saying something different. But this is just one simple way of looking at it, the moving average. Here's a crude oil market. Crude oil, a bearish signal was triggered on a crossover down into daily stochastics. Okay. What does that mean? So we've got T. Boone Pickens who says crude oil's going to $70 before the end of the year. Okay, better hurry up because we don't have that much time left, right? Crude oil is bopping along. As I said, it's been a very choppy market. Around $45 to $50. That's shown up here with the bar chart. And that's a moving average, that green line. And I forget, it might be a 9-day moving average. I forget what I put in there. But what this trader's talking about is the stochastic, the 15-day stochastic. And what is that? Well, a stochastic, as I told you, is kind of like an oscillator in that you define a price range. So we've defined one to equal the 15-day. So this is something that I just typed into the Wall Street Journal. This is part of the Wall Street Journal. I typed in a 15-day stochastic. So what does that mean? It means I'm giving a price range of 15 days. You know, Ken Roberts might take 10, you know, somebody else might take 25 or whatever, it doesn't matter. Over this 15 days, where is the settlement price relative to the range? Okay, are we near the high part of the range or are we near the low part of the range? And when this guy talks about the stochastics turning down, this is what he's talking about, this pink line. That's a 15-day stochastic. Okay. This blue line That's a moving average of the stochastic. So we can get very fancy here, right? We can calculate a stochastic, then we can do a moving average on the stochastic. But I'm not going to do that. Let's just look at stochastic turning down. So it's come down, right? It was around 100, and now it's down to 35. That's what he's talking about. So when you look at the price of oil up on top, you know, last week it was trading about $48, which was the very high end of the range over a 15-day period, right? Over that 15-day period, 48 was the high end of the range, so the stochastic was near 100. Now it's come down to 44, so it's now in the bottom half of that range. So given that the stochastic has come down, this trader is predicting that prices are going south. So if you look at some of the technical traders today, they'll tell you to sell oil. And as you well know, there are fundamental traders out there, apart from T. Boone Pickens, who will tell you to buy oil. So you have to decide. So difference of opinion, that's what makes the market interesting. You could have speculators who believe oil's going higher based on the fundamentals. You can have speculators who believe oil's going lower based on the technicals. Okay. How about a couple of questions? I don't want to jump into the next chapter. We just have 5 minutes left. So we can talk about efficient markets, fundamental trading, technical trading. Is anybody using technical trading in StockTrack? Not one person? Okay, next question. Is anybody using fundamental trading in StockTrack? One, two. Okay, what are the rest of you doing? Come on, you guys got to get with the program. We don't have much time left. You don't? What did I tell you the first day? So, you know, you just hurt my feelings saying that, yeah? What did I tell you the first day? It's worth 5% on the scoring sheet, but it's invaluable in terms of the knowledge you're going to pick up and the experience. And if you're not trading, it shows me you're not interested. That's you only do things if there's an incentive. Don't you? Okay. Yeah. Sorry, guys. There's a question here. I can't hear him. Okay. Please repeat it. Sorry. Oh, you mean what type of basket? Yeah, it would be. So the question is, when you're doing the purchasing power parity, would you use the same basket of goods as you would with, say, calculating a CPI? Well, not necessarily, because with a CPI, that includes a lot of services, you know, the price of a haircut, for example, and that's not tradable, right? I mean, you can't easily get a haircut in Beijing on the weekend. So that's going to be in the CPI, but it's not going to be in the PPP, because the PPP refers to tradable goods, goods that are going to cross the border, okay? You can buy a car in Europe, or you can, you know, you can buy other goods. Maybe the hamburger's not a good example, but you get the basic idea. It's the price of tradable goods that's going to move to arbitrage this and sort of equilibrate the prices. So it's just the difference between tradables and non-tradables. So non-tradables are goods that are consumed near the point of production, right? So if you get a haircut, you're going to have to get it locally. You're going to have to walk into the barbershop. Paul?
How big are the baskets of goods
they use? How big are the baskets of goods? Yeah, if you look at the IMF, they have PPP rates that they publish, and it's a large number. I can't tell you exactly whether it's 30 or 40 or 50, but it's a large number of items. they collect prices and data on, and then publish the PPP rate. So if you look at those rates, and there's some discussion in the textbook of these on a more general level, and I have some charts in there on PPP rates and some sources, it gives you a general idea of how far these currencies are out of line. You know? And there's interesting in many of these countries, a large number of those countries I had on the list, and I think I told you a story about Argentina last year, there's a black market in currency, right? And so, if I travel to one of these countries, I'll check the black market rate against the PPP rate, and it gives me some idea of what exchange rate you can get on the black market, and then you can use that money to spend while you're there, right? And so these black market rates, and there's a website that reports these black market rates too. That's another indicator of the extent to which the currencies are out of line.